Welcome to the Green Ring, and thanks for watching this note-by-note dissection of Wagner's Der Ring des Nibelungen. This video is first in a series of 16 devoted to Die Walküre, Act 1. Built on nearly two centuries of scholarly literature, it's a massive journey I hope you'll take when I'm dedicated to finishing. For an explanation of who I am and more on the reasons for this series, please check the preface video, first in a group of six building a foundation to this in-depth analysis. Before diving into this video, you may want to watch The Case for Erda, The Case Against Photon, and The Case for Loge, which present my views on how and why Wagner manipulates his musical syntax as he does, in the process identifying key morphemes which I believe define the entire work. You'll find explanations for why the terms leitmotif, motif, and motive have been replaced by morpheme, module, and cell in the chapter titled Music as Text. Links are provided in the comments below. My aim is to mount subsequent videos each week with breaks of approximately a month between each drama's acts until the entire ring is analyzed. This video, initiating the analysis of Die Walküre, Act 1 from the first notes of its prelude, requires some words of introduction. Whether Erda is the tetralogy's protagonist, Wotan or Alberich, its hero or villain, the ring's key mystery, its ultimate meaning, has remained an unsolved riddle since 1854, when August Riekel's letters to Wagner first puzzled over it. Shaw's 1896 essay, The Perfect Wagnerite, blames failed allegory, while the hints, guesses, and possible alternatives of subsequent analyses haven't produced a definitive answer. An increasingly popular tradition views this fault as a virtue. The ring's charm is its mystery. The tetralogy could be a single mind's interior dialogue, or a graph of musical history, or self-deconstruction, or a conundrum to stimulate metaphysical reflection. Its meaning isn't important, an enigma asking no solution. Burnett James embodies a tangential view, searching for the ring's meaning to conclude it definitively isn't there.
Goethe Demeron poses one of the great unanswered questions. Though Wagner came to understand it, the answer eluded him. The ring was a bold, courageous effort, a tremendous attempt, and a memorable achievement, but it failed.
James isn't alone, though opinions vary on the reasons for its underperformance.
The demands of the ring, from a moral, psychological point of view, simply could not be met by any single voice working on such a patchwork of material.
In the Götterdämmerung, we are back in the world of potions and disguises, of treachery and misunderstandings between lovers, all the apparatus of romantic opera.
Some of Götterdämmerung is rather ordinary melodrama. The old plot is not always equal to the new music, or to the philosophies Wagner has since waded through.
That the ring is a failure, in the artistic sense of the word, will probably be the verdict of posterity. From its very nature, it could not help being a failure. The unfortunate part about Wagner's ring is that he does not merely voice the mere crude notions of his own organism, but that these notions step outside the circle of art into those of philosophy and politics, and therefore provoke criticism from other than artistic sides. A novel that is a tract is bad enough. A poem that is a tract is infinitely worse. But what shall be said of a musical drama that is a tract?
Since Newman's day, Ring commentary has busied itself in decoding the allegorical tract supposedly at the work's core. The Green Ring eschews that approach, treating the work as pure narrative, its plot and characters requiring no symbolic or allegorical subtext. This minority viewpoint, however, argues for a host of covert schemes deep laid by the Meister in his text and music. the machinations of Loge and Erda. Whether entertaining or merely annoying, it has no more unearthed concrete solution to the work's ultimate riddle than have allegorists. It also raises its own contradictions, Erda's dubious benevolence causing more grief than good, who offers her gold to be robbed, leaves her Rhinemaidens empty-handed, and allows her giants to beat one another to death. She then delivers her Valkyrie daughter into the hands of her nemesis Votan, who embraces everything the Vala purportedly detests. This leads to frightful carnage, nearly all the work's characters dying horribly. If this madness is for no more than the elimination of Votan and Alberich, Erda is no better than they, her ethics just as bankrupt. But Erda may have a higher purpose. Death allows new life to flourish, clearing the field for coming generations as reflected in the work's foreground events, which none dispute.
The creation of the fittest to survive, and in this case is implied also the creation of a new order of the world, otherwise survival becomes not only itself irrelevant, but ultimately impossible. The environment and its inhabitants are mutually interactive, required, as it always requires, some special feature of birth and propagation. James refers to Votan's plans, but his comments also fit Alberich. God and dwarf alike engage in selective breeding to create a new world order. With cruel, ruthlessly self-serving methods, a mutual contempt for nature. Votan relies on incest, Alberich on lovelessness, both distorting nature's reproductive processes for their own gain. Erda seeks to pit their schemes one against the other to her benefit, as she does by answering Votan's Worldash rape with Alberich's Rheingold trap. These maneuvers aren't capricious spite, but, like those of God and Dwarf, serve a coherent agenda to eliminate their crimes against nature, subsuming them through the mutual fellow-feeling Rheingold gives short shrift into something like her original natural balance. Cook feels it's in Valkyrie.
The claims of love begin to assert themselves.
Dominated by these breeding schemes Erda opposes, it's an unlikely place for the Vala's mysterious agenda to blossom. Or so it seems. Virtually every ring analyst makes much of how Valkyrie comes almost out of the blue after Rheingold. Odd mythological settings and creatures banished, Act One takes place in a mortal dwelling among recognizably human characters, none of them from the previous drama. While Votan is mentioned so that audiences will recognize him, he's not seen until Act Two, and isn't called by his Rheingold name until nearly the end of his confrontation with Fricka. While Act One has some inevitable socio-political shadings, Act Two revolving around the power struggle established in its previous chapter, the drama is nonetheless overwhelmingly dominated by passionate interpersonal emotions. The events of Valkyrie boil down to a single category, generational conflict, the world of the young struggling to change that of the old. Spawned by the god, his Velsungs run afoul of his wife Fricka, their mother by common law, if not biology. Another of Fricka's common law offspring, Brunhilde, disobeys her biological father Votan, whose other Valkyrie daughters also have their rebellious moment. The drama runs hot in these close generational conflicts, and Cook feels Valkyrie's archetypal family squabbles engage audiences as Rheingold cannot, most analysts being of his mind. Siegmund, Sieglinde, Brunhilde, and Votan win a great deal of sympathy, with the Valkyrie a decisive favorite by opera's end. Had Fricka not interfered, Brunhilde could have defended Siegmund at her father's order to spare her disobedience and punishment. Votan's consort rarely charms audiences, but it's a mistake to cast her as the epic's lone troublemaker. The case isn't so simple. Tradition holds these heroic figures chafe at their blood ties strictly on their own initiative, but closer examination throws that in doubt. Fricka catalyzes all later sorrows when she routs her husband, based on the authority of his spear, whose law runes in the Rheingold prevent him cheating the giants. His Volsung expedient, meant to break that impasse, triggers Fricka's ban. All these complications lead back to Erda through the spear. Wotan cuts it from her world ash, and Cook notes the similarity between Alberich's ring and the god's weapon, both asserting the will to power specifically over nature. Erda has already got back some of her own when Valkyrie begins, Alberich having lost what he stole from her, Wotan unable to keep it for himself. The ring is now in the hands of her creature Fafnir, while the dwarf's abasement seems well underway. During the second part of the tale, she sets to work on the immortals and their proxies, estranging Wotan from his spear, his plans for world conquest along with it. The weapon's musical syntax, which predates Fricka's role in her consort's trouble, by right should be Valkyrie's first sonic issue, and so it is. As the house lights dim, Krebil's doubter nudges him.
"Dis the one's got the fat lady wid the steel bra?"
Shushing him, Krebil nods. Act 1's action begins with Zygmunt blundering into Hunding's dwelling for refuge from a storm, and it's generally agreed the prelude renders in sound the Velsung's flight through that tempest, a potent image of nature set against Wotan, represented by his demigod proxy. Wagner's earlier prose drafts sought to include the god himself on stage during this act, a notion the Meister discarded only reluctantly and late in the revision process. Instead, he embodies the god not merely in the poem's text, but through continuous syntactic references, as exemplified in the prelude's first measures. This modular bundle saturates the prelude, many analysts providing musical examples. Holman, Donington, and Spencer Millington overlook it, possibly on the basis it isn't a morpheme in the proper sense, as, after the prelude, its cells never sound again in quite this way. Cook alone grasps its part of the work's evolving syntax, though merely notes its falling scale derives from the spear. Not surprisingly, there's more to it. The cell's abrupt upbrush bears a striking resemblance to the ascending scale which, in Rheingold, connotes Mima's vain aspirations, evolves through Albrecht's boasts into resentment's bitter sting. The present narrative context, Zygmunt pursued by his mortal enemies, gives the syntax a potent flavor of those adversaries' racial descent, one made especially compelling when its spear module is immediately contradicted by another rising scale akin to the first. More than a picture of flight, this suggests an ongoing struggle, which, given the brewing racial war with which Rheingold ends, can only be won between Wotan's demigod spawn and mortals of Nibelung giant descent. This conflict also reflects Erda, the prelude as a whole, an unremitting tussle between natural rising-falling signs and those which fall and rise unnaturally. Zygmunt's Winterstürme later reveals Loge's Rheingold panegyric also shapes this nature module, in essence bending the spear to the unique sine wave figurations from that earlier passage, themselves derived from the Rheingold prelude, then passed through the Rhine Maiden's joy. What's more, the sign's lowest notes hint at the giant turn, suggesting their blood opposed to Zygmunt. The period to this succinct oral picture of interracial conflict is its conclusion, a Welterbe triad. From the moment Valkyrie begins, Loge and Erda preside over this clash for racial superiority, the module's falling-rising sign built on a spear variant, continuously assaulted then turned back on itself, an opposition met at last by Wotan's racial force. This bundle's down-up sign, overlapping thus corrected by a natural rise and fall, also evokes the god's ring woes. After the initial module echoes in its entirety, its natural sign repeats three times, then, at measure 8, returns for a single complete iteration, followed by one of its second natural sign, a fleeting hint the skirmish may turn in Zygbun's favor. Three full measures of the rising scale in its most wonted six-note guise of Nibelung hopes sweeps that hope away. The first two modules completed on plunging sixth into the next, thus replacing Welterb triads with chagrin. A third strophe increases the menace by rising into the next measure, extended through another four notes, briefly contradicted by the reverse melody notes of Votan's racial urge, only to rise another four notes. The spear cell appears to overcome this threat, extending its reverse melody notes by another six falling crotchets. The first time in the prelude, this module all but recreates its syntactic progenitor. It leads to the tussle's next phase, two repetitions of the opening bundle, now raised a harmonic whole tone, again followed by four measures of the first sign, then a pair of rising scales opposed by Welterb triads, initiating a slow crescendo. Only two pulses of the spear-opposing scale follow in its complete six-note guise, their sixth drops into the next, producing more chagrin iterations. What would have been its third strophe turns back on itself in reverse melody notes, then attempts to struggle up again only to be confounded a second time by reverse melody notes tinged with chromatics, the answering scale opposition equally tainted, Loge slyly putting in his hand. Reverse melody notes confound this, and in its next measure, its repetition, the entire line slowly raising its pitches along with the passage's tension. Two measures of the second wave module ratchet up the excitement, while returning Votan's defiance into the mix through his Welterbe. The Nibelung opposition lifts through a final iteration, again contradicted by reverse melody notes, met with melody notes to create a giant turn strophe, finished in a pair of erdacord notes. This crests in the prelude's first climax, a passage rifled with its own noteworthy syntactic details. The sequential upward leaps, the episode's cell most recognizable to the ear, sound first in bassoon's horns, then on high woodwinds, in their double impacts ascent across three octaves, cousin to their Rheingold counterpoints in that work's prelude, where the world-ash interval first stirs in its purest rising octave form, then later associated with the Rheingold itself. The double impact later acquires sinister associations, first in Rheingold Scene 2 as part of Freya's distress, then the giant's outrage, followed in Scene 3 as Alberich torments his Nibelung slaves. Rising octaves also develop through his vow to obliterate the gods, then expand in Scene 4 as the dwarf protests Votan's theft of the ring, there becoming the three found here. The bass driving this prelude here contributes additional syntactic detail, binding the others together. After a spear-like downward rush, which counters its Alberich-like echo, the rising spear-opposing scale, slowly evolving through the prelude's initial bars, plays its own significant role in this current syntax, especially as here, its six-note version suggests power directly opposed to Votan's. On its heels, falling rising signs in low octavo strings obsessively repeat for a total of four measures, the first two launched by their initial pitches dotted minims, the last three crushed together in a steady crotchet flow. These are the giant turn from Rheingold, which, together with the double impacts in octaves, amount to the first of many hints at what's become of the Titan race in this strange new world since Rheingold. Just as in the previous chapter, when the giants exit with Freya, the Morphine's Valkyr Act 1 prelude version is an unharmonized succession of rapidly thumping octaves. In both instances, an incarnation of the World-Ash octave tops their modules. Adding to the mix, the turn's continual flow overlaps falling-rising signs with opposing rising-falling, the latter evoking Votan's Rheingold plans for stealing the ring to settle the giant's score, the Meister pinpointing Votan's plans as exactly those which Erda's nature strives to thwart. As with all the ring, a full explanation surfaces only gradually through its continual syntactic evolution. After this pregnant bundle, four modules built from its falling spear-like portion sink by chromatic steps, here in semiquaver sextuplets, followed by the opposing scale rising on crotchets. This continues with another four measures of the unnatural sign in decrescendo, while frozen on the same pitches. At the quietest point, the last sign elides through a chagrin pulse to four measures of that threatening scale take over low strings, each countered by the immortal's Welterbe triad, Sigmund's foe or foes repeatedly stymied by his racial prowess, their struggle an apparent stalemate. Its last two measures initiate another crescendo, as it shifts to a pair of rising-falling signs, themselves muddling the giant turn with Votan's schemes, very like the prior measures. This syntactic clash between the god's hopes and those of his mortal adversaries grows still more uncertain through two additional measures, as the signs further confuse themselves with one another, then, in the last measure, rise in a chromatic scale, Loge tipping the balance surreptitiously in favor of Votan's enemies. At this point, Bar 55, Warfather himself steps in, enlisting Donner with the crashing return of the Thunderer's Rheingold morpheme. Unison-based tubas state the module first in its original bold major mode, after which they lapse into a pedal as tenors follow with a second pulse, lapsing in turn into their own pedal, while third, fourth trombones take a third pulse, bass trumpet joining first, second trombones with a fourth, all three trumpets added to third, fourth trombones for a fifth. The whole rises to climax, progressively etching more definitively minor harmonies, as horns creep up double breve chromatic Erda melody notes, while, with each measure's third and fourth beat, high woodwinds rise through quintuplet semiquavers, as in the prelude's opening, top notes held as minim crotchets. Strings provide a canonic series of the full initial sign, descending crotchets fingered as quavers. First violins reinforced by the woodwind modules, all thrusting the spirit's falling motion towards some kind of anticipated triumph or disaster, as the case may be. With the final trumpet trombone Donner iteration, woodwind string uprushes change imperceptibly to septuplets, and with the Donner pedal's next downbeat, scalar woodwind loge chromatics rise for three measures in crotchet triplets, horn doubling joining them on the last beat of their second measure. More woodwind voices swell the third, a powerful crescendo which, along with the definitive harmonic shift to minor seventh mode, heightens the climax's anticipation. The sequence peaks on an onomatopoeic lightning strike triggered by merged flutes, oboe, first violins on the upbeat with a last septuplet uprush. In the next downbeat, the entire orchestra falls silent as, across two measures, a thunderclap rolls on double timpani, a second player added for Valkyrie, its fortissimo supported by a lone contrabass tuba pedal. Diminishing into a third measure, second timpanist drops out with a crotchet stroke after a minim, tuba lapsing after a minim, the remaining timpani rolling into the next crescendo. With this measure's second upbeat, horns woodwinds howl a Donner evolution, sinking in minor seventh harmonies, its first downbeat punctuated by quaver strings and staccato crotchet brasses, trumpets doubling the morpheme's initial pair of rising intervals, trombones its last two. As it disappears across the next measure, both timpani crescendo through a second thunderclap, followed by another Donner evolution slightly less reinforced by woodwind's brass strings. A third timpani thunderclap, this time even less powerful, evokes its own echoing, more attenuated Donner pulse, while the penultimate timpani thunderstroke triggers a last Donner strophe, reduced to a hush on clarinet's bassoons, downbeat punched by a dotted minim horn chord, the whole atop first timpani's final softly answering thunder roll. With a crotchet strike on the next downbeat, first timpani gives way to second, whose rumble, the only remaining sound, lingers a semi-breve minim. Newman marks this passage as a sign of the Meister's burgeoning symphonic powers, which it certainly is. The Donner morpheme, prominent in the last minutes of Rheingold, here reassures audiences unconscious of the prelude's other syntax that, unrelated as it might seem at first, this new drama links directly to that first chapter. Lehnhoff's 1980s production underscores this Donner thunder effect, with Photon appearing out of nowhere to brandish his spear as it flings open the door to Hunding's residence, allowing Siegmund to enter. This directorial touch corresponds nicely with the music's climax, but at the cost of its syntax, confusing Donner with Votan, in effect saying cow when we see a horse. Lehnhoff's instinct is sound, in that the Donner morpheme suggests divine intervention, which, in Rheingold, banishes the specters of frustrated love and deadly violence only to presage their return in Valkyrie, the module's dark harmonies suggesting trouble awaits the immortal and his demigod offspring. This one instance proves what's generally taken for Donner's personal morpheme isn't that at all, but a sonic recall of his powers over lightning and thunder. In turn, it highlights a key feature of Wagner's musical syntax, obscured by claims that too often the Meister obsessively trots out his every module without narrative purpose. Newman is especially prone to this complaint, along with much of Stein's confusion over morpheme use, especially in Götterdämmerung. Despite more than a century of opinion to the contrary, itself reinforced by the long-standing habit of morpheme naming, none of the drama's characters have syntax directly attached to them, in order to flash like a neon sign whenever they appear. The module Cook dubs Albrecht's personal morpheme repeats twice in scene 1, once at the beginning of Rheingold scene 3, then a fourth time as the dwarf torments his fellow Nibelungs, to forever disappear thereafter, although the dwarf himself certainly doesn't. Mina has no personal syntax, nor do Fricka, Hagen, Gunther, Gutrune, nor even Wotan himself. Freya's Rheingold syntax may seem personal to her, but its subsequent deployment throughout the epic leaves no doubt it references not the goddess herself, but the various aspects of love over which she exerts her powers. Even Fafner's syntax, which so annoys Newman in Siegfried, identifies not the giant dragon personally, but the Tarnhelm's magic responsible for his condition. Even those modules ascribed to Siegfried and Brunhilde aren't highway signs, as it were, telegraphing their appearance on stage, but markers of the various ideas and emotions surrounding them. The Meister's syntax evolves, not individuals but concepts, frames of mind, even events related to those individuals in terms of the emotional psychological reactions these incidents recall. Even spear and sword, the two most likely candidates as signpost morphemes, expand subtler connotations of the power invested in and by those two physical items. All the work's syntactic modules, routinely misunderstood as personal morphemes, are instead oral insights into character, feelings, even tangential yet related ideas surrounding those characters. This addresses a primal error of countless productions, which neglect to provide on-stage visuals consistent with the syntax. In opera and drama, Wagner refers to this as gesture, generally taken for the performer's physical behavior, even though his text leaves no doubt the term applies to the entire stage picture. His consideration of gesture develops through that large essay's final third, but one of its earliest comments sums up his position.
Thus a hearing is to be aroused to greater sensuous interest. The messenger involuntarily has to address the eye as well. Eye and ear must mutually assure each other of a higher-pitched message before they can transmit it convincingly to the feeling.
His statement's full implications lie outside the current text's purview, but it's a clue to how Lenhoff's Donnermorpheme staging, if bold, exemplifies both how directors run afoul of the epic syntax and why accurate morphemic charting is essential, never mind stage design, which heeds it. The Donner case is especially instructive given its syntax repeats only four times, its context unmistakable, its sound pictorially exact. The problem begins with its wrangled appearance. No staging available on video provides what the morpheme asks, meaning lightning flashes precisely synchronized with each module's iteration, their unquestioned source, Donner's hammer. By itself, this would redeem Lenhoff's Valkyrie staging, requiring nothing more during that next recurrence than sparkles of lightning behind Votan coordinated with the morpheme's iterations. The rising chromatic scale on Woodwind's horns, in echo of Rheingold's just before Donner strikes, is a tangential issue whose climax in the Valkyrie Act I prelude leads to its four progressively quieting Donner pulses. That's a different staging riddle, which future directors will hopefully solve themselves. I think you'll agree this is enough for a first plunge into Die Walküre, Act 1, and hope it whets your appetite for more. The next video picks up where this one leaves off, page 15 of Dover's full score, Second Stave. As always, thanks for watching, and please do leave your comments below. Time and energy allowing, I'll do everything I can to respond. Lastly, as all YouTubers know, your subscription to this channel by itself is a huge assist in completing this vast project. Hit the bell to be notified of the next videos. With luck and your support, there's a lot more to come.